slide that's up here. I also tweeted it out. We're going to be chatting about automating WordPress updates with visual regression testing. Nothing quite different on the slides, but that's what we're going to be chatting on. My name is Andrew. I'm an agency and community engineer at Pantheon. I help our agency partners and then contribute back to code and speaking at camps and things like that. Outside coding, I like to stay active, like soccer. And all of these things are great. My Twitter handle's up here. I tweeted the slides. If you want to grab those, you can do that. It's ataylorme. But besides all of these things, I'm a maintainer of websites. And I'm sure, how many of you have, you know, your friends or family find out that you do stuff with the internet, and now you have to make a site for them, right? That happens to a lot. So I have some of those sites I have to maintain. There's also client work and everything else. And it's a pain, it's a burden. So that's what we're going to talk about, is how we can kind of get through that and make that a little bit easier and automate that. So I want to start talking a little bit about continuous integration. This is something we need to understand a bit before we can know how to leverage it for automating our updates. And if you haven't used continuous integration before, it's essentially the idea of letting the robots do the work. So this could be things like installing dependencies if you're compiling SAS into CSS, or maybe you're doing something cool with React and you need to run Babel or whatever the hot new front-end thing is. All of those steps can be automated. We can also have tests. You could check for WordPress coding standards, for example. You could run unit tests and things. You can automate deployments, so if you create a new branch in your Git repository, then you could have that spin up an environment somewhere and deploy your code automatically. These are all cool. There's plenty of services that handle continuous integration. I'm going to be working with CircleCI, but there's a ton of alternatives, so don't feel like you have to be locked into anything. But it's really kind of nice if you have this already set up and you're familiar with continuous integration. It's basically a space where you can run arbitrary commands. And so those are some of the standard things you do, is compiling SAS and items like that. But we're actually going to combine it with WPCLI to automate all of our updates. So this is just what CircleCI looks like. Like I said, it just runs commands that you tell it to run. So this can be bash scripts, this can be PHP or Node or whatever you want to do. So before we get into the details, I want to back up and talk about why you want to do this. If you've ever gone into the WordPress admin and you've clicked, you know, update plugins and themes, that's not too terrible of a task, but those updates can come out, you know, every week, sometimes more than once a week. And that's still okay if you're just managing a site, but what happens when you manage 5 sites? Or you get clients and you're managing 20? 50, 100, it's really not scalable to go in and do that manually. Especially I see a lot of agencies who want to maintain a relationship with their client after they pass off a project. And having some sort of maintenance retainer is a great way to do that. And so you can go in and you keep things up to date for them. Maybe you do so many hours of work and bundle all these things together. But you can only do that for so many clients when you're having to do these updates. Another reason it's important is modern software is versionless. So if you use like Chrome or Dropbox or even Microsoft Edge and things, they don't have a version number. You don't go download a new version of Chrome. It's updating itself. And I think WordPress is really great for this model because of the commitment to backwards compatibility. You can update between WordPress versions and things are typically going to go okay. It's, you know, with plugins and things, you sometimes will have collisions, and sometimes not. That's why we're going to test as well. But especially WordPress 4, when we're running security updates, it should just work. And that's where we want to automate it so that WordPress itself almost becomes versionless, because that's what modern software is. So WordPress has this built-into core, the automatic update system. And so when WordPress 4.2 came out, millions of sites were updated, which is really awesome. But there's also some issues with this. You have to have your files in production writable, which can be a security issue. You also have to go in and just trust that when these updates run, things are going to work. And for the most part, they do, but sometimes they don't. And also, WordPress automatic updates only cover core. It's not updating plugins and themes and things that you still have to go in and update. So that's where we're going to take this idea of automatic updates, and we're really going to take it to the next level. So when we're talking about why this is important, this is a quote from Andrew Nason's talk, Anatomy of a Critical Security Bug. If you haven't seen it, I recommend you watch it. It talks about when WordPress got Emoji, it was really a security patch, and they go into all kinds of the hairy details behind that. But it was an attack that relied on MySQL truncating everything. Basically, every WordPress site was vulnerable without this update to 4.2. And so if you had sites out there, so let's say, you know, this security update is announced, it's a really big one. You come in and you start patching your sites, but the clock is ticking. Because when this came out, and it was announced and things, there were already proof of concepts and stuff out there on the web within like hours. So you really have to go in and be diligent about applying your updates. So if you do them even like the same week or a day later, it can be too late. Or if you're applying them and maybe you're really on it, like you find out within a couple hours and you start patching your sites, but let's say you have a staging environment, right? We all like to follow best practices, so you apply your updates, then you have to go click through all the pages, make sure things are still working, do all of your QA, and deploy things out, but you have to do that for multiple sites and multiple clients, and that clock keeps ticking. It's really not a great way to go because your sites are going to be vulnerable while you're running these updates. And it's, like I said, it's really kind of a pain, and it's not scalable for you to do this every time there's an update to WordPress itself, to plugins and themes. You would have to be doing this process, you know, daily almost. It was a pain. If we use WPCLI and scripting, we can get a bit better because we could run a mass update script to apply the updates to the staging environments of all of our sites, but then we still have to go site by site and do that QA in that deployment to make sure that things look good and aren't broken before we send it out to production after these updates. So this is what we're going to talk about, is taking that a step further. And so we're going to automate the updates with WPCLI, but then we're also going to use visual regression testing to test and do our QA, and then if everything looks good, deploy that out automatically. And visual regression testing is great for updates because it's basically taking screenshots of different environments or different URLs. So we'll have our live site and then we'll have our staging site where all the updates are applied. And we'll take screenshots of both of those, and the visual regression test will actually compare them. And if you think, I know before tools like this, I would go do QA after running plugin updates and things. And I would click around the home page, maybe a couple of other pages, but how many of you have ever clicked through the entire site every single time you run updates, right? That's tough. And typically we don't do as thorough of a job as we should be doing, but letting the robots do it and having these tools, your site has 100 URLs, 1,000, they can test all of them, right? Where you're not going to sit there and spend that time doing it yourself, going through 100 URLs. So this is sort of what the tests look like. We have a before piece of content. We have an after piece of content, and you can maybe spot the difference there with the headings. And then the visual regression will go in and show the differences. So we can see the areas are lit up red there that are different. And I noticed the headings, but at first glance, you might not notice the little read more link. Right? Things like that it can catch. And again, it can do this for all of your URLs. And beyond that, it will actually produce reports. So here's an actual report from the test that I ran. And so we can see, in this case, images weren't loading. And so that's something, if I look at the image on the left, and I'm just doing a quick QA myself, I might miss that. I might go, this page looks good. There's the heading, there's content, whatever, we're fine. And I missed the fact that this background image didn't load, but the visual regression caught it, and it lit that up, and it failed the test. So this idea of doing a reference, which is going to be our staging site that has all the updates, compare that to our production site, and if there's any differences, then we can go in and be alerted to that and fix those things. There are some limits to visual regression testing. So sometimes you can get noise in the process. You can set a different level of threshold. So instead of a perfect match, maybe you'll accept 2% or 5% difference, and that's okay. Sometimes there's false positives. And probably the biggest drawback is difficulties with dynamic content. So if you have an ad that's always changing, maybe you have a rotating banner on the home page. A lot of these tools will have a way that you can ignore those sections, which is fine because the test will still run. But then if you know you update the plugin for that rotating slider on the home page and that breaks because you're ignoring it, you're not going to catch that. So visual regression testing is a good first step, but I would say add some other tests on top of it. And so using that with security updates, this is the WordPress exploit we were talking about before. If we have our site before security updates and after security updates, it should look exactly the same. So that's where we can run our visual regression tests. So the idea with the scripting and what we're actually going to use continuous integration to do and to run the script for us is check if updates are available. If they're not, then we can actually document that we even checked, and we can send that out to the client and let them know that we're keeping their site up to date. And that's something we can invoice them for, charge that maintenance repair. If updates are available, then we're going to create a new Git branch if you're working with version control, copy our database and our files from the live environment, create the staging environment, apply and commit all of the updates available. So using WPCLI to do that, you can update all of your plugins, all of your themes from the command line, and that's important to have it run the script, and then actually run the visual regression test. And additional testing, like I said, visual regression is a great start, but depending on the type of project, you might want more. So if I'm running an e-commerce site, the visual regression isn't going to tell me if my shopping cart is broken. So I might want to write some VHAT tests or some additional logic around that on top of the visual regression test. And so our tests run, and if there's no issues, all of our tests pass, then we can actually merge those updates back into master if we're using version control on Git, deploy those updates, run further tests if you want, and then send them out to production and actually invoice the client and let them know. Shoot them an email that says, hey, we updated your site. Here's all the things that we updated for you. And they'll be getting these emails from you. They'll know that you're doing your job. But they don't have to know that the robots are actually doing it. It's not you in there clicking buttons on a Saturday, right? If there are issues in testing, then it can let you know, and you're going to see the reports. And if we go back to saying a site that has 100 URLs, well, if only two of them fail, maybe it's just one template we have to go fix. That still saves me a bunch more time than going to look at 100 pages manually to figure out where things are broken. So even when the tests fail, it's saving you time because it's actually doing the bulk of the QA and pointing out the problems. And there are some items that you'll need for this. So a continuous integration solution. Again, I'm going to be showing Circle CI, but there's Travis and Bitbucket and Jenkins and a ton of other ones out there. Use whatever you like. You will need command line tooling. So you'll need the ability to run WPC LI, create a staging environment if you need to, apply those updates. So that'll depend on your host or wherever your site's living. And then again, you know, a platform that's going to support scripting and automation through the command line. And I also have example code, so this is linked in the slides. There's a repo here, and it has the full script, so if you're interested in setting this up, go check out the repository. There's a README in there that tells you how to get up and going. And so now, let's take a look. So this is my visual regression test, and I'm going to run it manually here. Just click restart, but normally I run this every day or every hour. You can just set a cron and actually call out to the CircleCI API and fire off the test. So I'm not usually going in here and clicking the button. I'm doing it just because I want to run it right now. But you can set it up to run every hour. So as soon as those updates come out, you're always checking and testing and seeing what's going on. So it's going to fire off. I'm going to pull open. I have it actually hooked up to Slack as well. So I talked about you can send emails to clients to let them know what things you've updated. I just hooked it up to Slack in this case so that we can go in and actually see the results as things are happening. So it's going to take a minute to spin up and get going, but then we should see some of the magic. Actually, while that gets started, I can show you guys what some of the reports look like. So at the end of this running, I'll actually get a report every time the updates run. So if there's plugin or theme updates to apply, I'll run the visual regression testing. And here's what a pass looks like, is it's going through and it's actually going at different breakpoints between mobile and tablet and desktop and crawling all of the URLs on my site. And then if something fails, we get that report where we have you know, sort of our updated site on the left. In the middle, we have the live site. And then we can see that those images were broken and we have that failure. And we can go in. And it actually tells me, if I come in, all the pages it tested. And it tells me this Elastic Architecture page failed. And it happened when it was on the desktop breakpoint. So I could come in and, or actually phone breakpoint. So I know that I need to go look at that on mobile to figure out where the failure is. So it checked WordPress core. WordPress core was up to date, but we're actually going beyond that. And now we're running WPC LI, and we have updates available. For plugins, so I have Kismet, I have this GitHub sync, I have WordPress SEO, which is the Yoast plugin. So now it's actually running plugin update all, which is the WPC LI command to update the plugins. So it's going to go through and do that. Themes are up to date, so it's just going to skip those. And now, we're actually going to kick off our visual regression test. So it's testing my updated environment against my live environment. And I'm going to come back and see if there's any difference. And if there's no difference, it will deploy things all the way out to live. And if there is a difference, then I'm going to get notified and I can go check it out, figure out where the issues are, resolve those, and then rerun things. If we go back to CircleCI, we can actually see it's still running the test. So it's going right now, and it's taking all of those screenshots from the different URLs. So we can see all the different screenshots it's capturing, all the URLs, all the different breakpoints. And again, this is saving you time. You don't have to go in and do all of this QA manually. This is running automatically. You don't even have to sit here and watch CircleCI. I could be asleep and this could be running know, at 2 in the morning checking for updates. All right, so I captured the screenshots. Now it's going to generate the test. So I captured all the screenshots from our update URL. So now it's going to go capture screenshots from the live site and then start the comparison. And the tool I'm using for this is called Backstop.js. It runs on Node. There's a lot of visual regression testing tools, so definitely use whatever you're comfortable with. But if you go look at the example code, that's what is going to be in there, and it's pretty easy to use. You pass it the breakpoints, you pass it the URLs you want, and it will take care of things. So there it goes, it took all the screenshots from the live site, and now it's actually running the comparison, so that's what it's doing here. It's generating the report. You can see it's actually an HTML report, so it's generating all of the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript and things like that. Now if we go back and look at Slack, that everything looked good, we have no visual differences, so it's going to go in and actually merge this branch with our updates back into master, and then work on deploying it all the way out to the live website. I'd show you kind of the before and after, but the whole point of this is that it looks exactly the same. So if I show you the live site now and after it finishes, it's not much of a demo. But we can see that it's going in, it's actually, I have a git commit message of auto deploy updates, and so I can go back. And I can actually, since I'm using version control, I'll actually have a commit that's going to list which of these plugins were updated, which is pretty nice. So I can go back, look at that, figure out what's going on, ever issues. And the deployment will just take a few minutes, but then again, we'll get a report like this. I expect to see passed because everything passed. And then actually, if I run it again, I made sure that my site had updates available this time. But if I rerun it once this is done, it should go much faster because all it's going to do is ask WPCLI, do we have updates? And if there's nothing available, then it's done. It doesn't do the visual test, it doesn't do deployments unless we actually have updates to apply. So here we go, deployed out to my test environment. So this is the point, if I wanted to do more QA, if I didn't want to go all the way to production, maybe you have couple of projects that are bigger clients that you want to do more of a manual inspection for, you can do that. Otherwise, if you have smaller sites with not a lot of complexity, then you can automate that deployment all the way out to the live site. And again, this is just running visual regression testing, but the more complex your site is, the more types of testing you'll want to do in addition to visual regression before you ship all the way out to the live environment. Because the whole idea here is we want to mitigate risk, and we're comfortable that once the test passed, that I don't need to do any more manual QA. So you want to have enough tests that it's going to do all the QA that you would normally do. So it's actually creating a backup. So that's another nice thing. I want to make sure I have a backup before I send these out to the live website. So definitely important to do that. And then once that's done, it'll deploy out. So that's sort of the demo there. We have some time for Q&A. So there's mics. Please use the mic if you're going to ask a question. But hopefully you guys have seen that you can kind of automate this process, really take some work off of your plate, and keep all of your sites updated and secure.
So it looked like you had your stage in your live were both public facing, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And are there other combinations you can do, like a local server against public facing, or even the current version of the live against after the updates live? Are those combinations that are possible?
Those combinations are possible, but when you're running the visual regression test, like CircleCI runs in the cloud, and so it cannot access if you have like local host or, right? It can't access that. You could run the test from your machine, but then that sort of defeats the purpose of it running every hour and you sleeping. So it really kind of depends. And you could have it take all of the screenshots of the live environment, deploy your updates, wait, and then take screenshots again, and then generate the report after is something you can do. But the whole point is to not deploy to the live environment if things are mismatched. So if you're taking your screenshots after you've already deployed it and there's a problem, then you're gonna have to restore a backup or do something else, because it's, you're kind of defeating the purpose at that point, because you might be shipping something broken. And the whole point of the test is to make sure we don't do that.
Yes, I understand. I'm thinking of maintaining a site where the risk is low, or the cost of restoring from backup is low compared to running the staging environment simultaneously.
Yeah, and in that scenario, you definitely could create a backup, deploy it, and then take your screenshots before and after, and if things fail, restore the backup.
Two questions. How does it determine the links to visit?
Yeah, so if you have protected content, it's the tool I'm using, Backstop, runs on top of Wraith, and so it has a pretty lightweight API, so it can't do authentication and things, but there are tools that they're a little more time consuming to set up, because you have to set up all these steps for it to log in, but it's essentially using the headless browser. So anything that you can do that way, then you can log in. Another way I would test that is do visual regression on things that are public and anonymous, but use BHAT testing or something else where you can authenticate. And if you're testing something like someone logs in and they have access to a download, then you could do that with a BHAT test, and you could lock the scenario of them actually logging all the way in, being able to access the link for the PDF and download it and those things. So that's why I said use multiple types of tests. Visual regression is a pretty good baseline for a lot of sites, because that's kind of the first thing that you naturally do after you run updates, is go look at the site to make sure that it looks the same. And so if we can get that out of the way, then you can start automating other tests and other things that you might do in your QA process.
And
then,
so the second question, is it actually comparing pixels to pixels, or is it doing it like comparing DOM nodes to DOM nodes?
It's actually pixel to pixel. So
how does the exclusion stuff work?
The exclusion stuff will actually go in and you give it like a div ID or class name, and it will either hide it or remove it before it takes the screenshot, and then it will do the pixel to pixel comparison. Or it will basically paint over that div black or something. It kind of depends on the tool. But that way, if you have like a rotating add in sidebar, it'll, you know, convert that to black on most sites, take the screenshots, and then there'll be a match. Any other questions? All right. Well, you can rerun it one more time while we have this question, just for fun. Can you speak up a bit?
Can you give us your Twitter?
The Twitter? Yeah, ATaylorME. And so I tweeted out a link to the slides. You'll be able to find that. I can also go back to the starting slide here as well as the link. Then again, the code repository is sort of linked towards the end, so if you pull up the slides, you can actually pull up the script I'm using to do this. I'm deploying to Pantheon, but you might have to configure some things if you're deploying elsewhere, like update it, you know, to deploy out to your servers. But you'll have a good baseline, and all the WPCLI stuff and the visual regression and things are there.
Related to the other question, how do you pick the list of URLs that you're going to check against? For like a larger site that may have hundreds or thousands of pages, you may not want to check everything. Do you have like some criteria that you use to pick the pages that you're going to test?
Yeah, so actually the visual regression test, you know, we saw that before when it ran, I can go back and it's estimated that it takes about 12 minutes, and I'm running like 50 URLs. So that time can definitely creep up. What I would say if you only want to do a sample is make sure it's a representative sample. So make sure that you're getting a category page, an author page. If you have custom templates, do those. If you have different post types, you know, get each of some of those, and making sure that you're covering all of the visual different areas on your site. So just making sure that if you have, that you're testing like two or three blog posts, and if that blog template looks good on, you know, three or four of them, chances are it's going to look good on the rest. So whatever your comfort level is, just making sure that you do cover at least every template that you have and every post type.
Anyone else? Going once?
Going twice?
All right, cool. Well, you can see when I ran it the second time that there was nothing to update, so it just says, have a nice day. So again, this is something that you can run every day, every hour, and it will make it so you can apply security updates, plugin updates, theme updates to all of your sites in a timely manner and in a scalable way. So you can do this for all of your clients, and then with the visual regression testing in place, you're mitigating that risk, and you don't have to worry about, oh, did I just deploy something broken, because we have the test set up. Thank you, guys. Reminder, there are closing remarks right in the room next to us, so don't, you know, totally leave yet. Hang around for those.